them will be executed by the people whom they elect, but will be independently adjudicated by the people who are the experts of law. And therefore, the rule of law became the quintessence of democracy. Democracy is not necessarily this thing of the ballot box. It is about that those who will make the laws will come through the process of the ballot box and will make the laws which will be binding not only on you but also on those who make it. So that is how the extreme views were tried to be reconciled. But the people who came from the ballot box to make the laws, or the executive that was elected, could not always measure up to the confidence that was reposed by the people in their ability to protect the state, its citizens, and its progeny. And that is why the dilemma gets into a state of confusion, and fundamentals are lost, and therefore we think that probably much can be said on either side. I don't think that there's much can be said on either side. Let human failings not be taken as the failings of the system or the failings of the concepts and the doctrines. Because at the end of the discussion, all thinkers have accepted one thing, and all practitioners have accepted one thing, that if human beings have to live in a community, it requires an order. And this order has got to be administered by someone. And for the sake of convenience, we call it a state, whatever the form of a state. If you become a hermit and go to this thing and you are leading a life of total isolation, probably the rules of the state may not apply to you. But if you are a social animal and living in a society, and if your conduct is going to affect my survival status, my pattern of life, then how can you have the total freedom and I too have the total freedom? How can you have this freedom to shoot and I may not have the freedom to defend myself or to retaliate? So an order will have to be made. Who will have freedom up to what level? What are the costs and what are the responsibilities? There is another reason for that. That the citizens individually cannot protect themselves against large number of the new threats and this thing that came. It's only the collective security that can be provided to them. If you have got weapons of mass destruction or the modern wars or the nuclear weapons or the anything, terrorism, what can a single individual do against that onslaught? So the state became the necessary. But there's also another important point that, okay, like disarmament, you can't say that I believe in disarmament, so I'm throwing away my weapons when everybody else will keep it. I believe in disarmament so that I can have such a powerful weapon that I can make all of you to throw your weapons. And therefore, after I'll throw my also. But you can't have that this thing that living in the community of nations where you are being subjected by pulls, pressures, influences, by what the other nations are doing, that you are not in a position to defend yourself, to protect yourself and your people and your citizens. You can't say that somebody has got the freedom to carry on the terrorist acts against you, but you probably think that the state has got no right or a privilege to use its power, which will deprive somebody of his life. Now, when we say that state is inevitable, it is required, this organization, the structure is required, then the first question that arises is, okay, what is the first duty, what is the first charge on this institution? From the time that the concept of the state and the nation state and this thing have evolved in many years, the first duty of the state has been to protect itself, is the self-defense. And that has also been the cause of large number of problems. That is, the state has to protect itself. When we say India, what is the first duty of this government of India? Is to ensure its territorial integrity, its sovereignty, core values of its constitution, security of its citizens, continuity of its institutions, protection of its civilizational and cultural values. That is the preservation, it is the protection of the self, whatever you decide as the ingredients of the self of the society. Now, in this protection of the self, the conflict of values is automatic. Because when you are protecting your rights in the defensive mode or in the defensive offense mode, conflicts are bound to arise. And those conflicts will sometimes be to my advantage and sometimes to somebody else's advantage. We will have to take the package in totality and accept it. That is, the traffic regulation, and the traffic has to move in an orderly way, and there has got to be a traffic constable there, then I will have to learn to wait till my time comes. And maybe that somebody is lucky that when his time comes, the moment he reaches, there is a green light. So, asking that there will be a perfect equality at every time, in every situation, in every occasion, and making the comparisons is a logically fallacious issue. It is not sustainable, it is not tenable, it is not doable. It has never happened, it will never happen. But the system in totality must be fair and upright. Now, in the statecraft, earlier the statecraft was more confined to the question of wars. The rules of wars were made, the Vienna Convention was made, what are the permissible type of weapons which can be used, what is the type of the mines that can be laid and they cannot be laid, but the claymore mines can be put or no more they can be put. All these things have been settled to a large extent. Prisoners of wars will be this thing. But the days of statecraft through wars is coming almost to an end. Wars are no more an effective instrumentality of achieving your political and strategic objectives in a cost-effective way. There is no guarantee that a very powerful nation with a huge arsenal, with a huge economy, with a huge intelligence capability, with a great scientific prowess, would be able to subdue even a small group of the terrorists. Whether it's the United States in Vietnam or the Soviets in Afghanistan. So people are increasingly thinking that probably it is not the most effective way. You are not able to achieve your strategic objectives through the mechanisms of war. That has evolved into the statecraft, the other institutions or the other props of the statecraft becoming quite important. In any case, the like Walzer's theory about the morality of the war itself has brought into the focus. And even most of the countries which are engaging in war have found it, that it has been unaffordable diplomatic cost for them to sustain that. So in this background, new instrumentalities like diplomacy, intelligence, perception management, your media and this thing, use of soft power, influencing the minds of the people, that have become the new instruments of the statecraft. In a way, have you ever wondered why the Americans decided to support the Islamic gun-wielding irregulars against a regular Soviet army? It had many options. When the Soviets made an entry in Afghanistan, they could have taken them militarily. They could have done their economic blockade. They could have taken it to the UN Security Council. They could have passed any resolution against them. They would have tried all means which are available to a much greater power of the world. But it resorted to something entirely different mechanism. That was the mechanism of the covert war. That is the proxy war. You are fighting against someone, using somebody else's manpower, using somebody else's weapons. You fly the weapons from Egypt, which are of the Russian origin, send it to Peshawar and then distribute it to the Mujahideen, and then send them to Afghanistan. Because they found that the other means of the statecraft were unaffordable against a country which had a great strategic weapon presence. Now that is the dilemma. That this is statecraft, war is more transparent. But war through other means which Clausewitz had defined is much more dicey and much more difficult to handle. These proxy wars, these covert wars, espionage, sabotage, subversion, influencing the minds of the people sitting in this hall. If I can make all of you think the way that I want you to think and behave, I wield a power over you. The real power in the coming times will not be wielded by those people who are going to have control over your lands, or over the technology, or over the means of production, or over the wealth. It will be wielded by people who can make you think the way that is in their interest. If I want you to buy a product and you buy that, I control your minds. If I want you to hate everything that is Indian, I want you to be ashamed of your culture and civilization. And if I achieve that, I win the battle. If you resist it and you are not able to do this thing, you win the battle. This is the battle of civilization, the battle of culture. It's basically the battle of minds. It is all by exercising through the soft powers. And statecraft has got us the new instrumentalities. Now, I think I've spoken for long, but basically I would like to conclude briefly by telling that state is necessary. And if it is necessary, protecting itself will continue to remain its supreme important role. And to perform that role, it will have to develop capabilities to protect its vital interests. And for that, it will have to employ the statecraft that is necessary to protect the state. Individual morality cannot be inflicted on the larger interest of the society and the nation, whereas the individuals must have the liberty and the freedom in their personal lives to have their liberties of following their values, but it cannot be superimposed on the larger interest of the society. There cannot be any unilateralism when the nation is threatened, and therefore the nation will have to take recourse to all means which are necessary to protect itself, not only for the present generation, but for the coming generation. The state may belong to those who are its citizens today, but the nation belongs to those who were part of this thing 1,000 years back. Maharana Pratap and Shivaji are as much part of this nation today as they were when they were alive. And the people who have to come after 1,000 years, we owe a responsibility for them. And therefore, we cannot subjugate and subordinate anything that is going to affect our long-term vital interest for the sake of these small things. So when state acts in a way which is judicial, which is fair, which is through due process of law and not for furtherance of any vested interest, its actions are totally correct and they are not murderous, and they are not that does not reduce you to the level of murderers. Let us all have the confidence and confidence to do what is right for the sake of the nation and not get confused about these artificial contraption of that there is a conflict. In reality, there is no conflict. In reality, there are parallel values in which there is a plurality of the values in which we can live, the generations have lived, and the coming generations will have to live. In a family, we live with those plural values. We have got a relationship with our elders, with our parents, with our wife, with our children. They are all decided and governed by the different set of values. So it's not one thing that you can superimpose on others, and therefore the formulation that any instrumentality, any coercive instrumentality used by the state reduces it to the status of murders is totally untenable. Thank you very much.